get started. Okay, so we have today the third session, and today we are going to talk about bar graph. But before I start, I know some of you tried by yourselves to do something with the previous lecture, so compiling Sphino, running Sphino, and so on. If you take the template that is provided automatically by Sphino for the input for Sphino, you know, this Lejeune's templates, there is no problem with that, but you have to be careful because there are some options that I change. So in the Lejeune file that I send you as example, there are some options that have to be like that. So it's very important. I didn't have time yesterday to explain every option in the flag, the meaning of every option, but I mean, if you just have a look at the example I gave you and you try to reproduce it, it will work for sure. And if you change something, in principle, there is no problem, but there might be some problems if you change some of the details which are, for example, relevant for micromegas and so on. So I recommend to have a look at the notes because all these details that I don't have time to explain are explained in the notes, so you can read them. Okay, so let's continue. Today we are going to have a session on MatGraph. This is a very complicated code that has been growing and growing for many years. And actually, the proof that this is a complicated code is the number of people who are involved, probably even more than the people that I work here. They call themselves the math team. These are not my words. This is how they like to call themselves. And well, what I mean by a lot of people is that you can easily find on the net talks, courses, and a lot of resources about MatGraph, which are way more specialized than what I'm going to tell you today. So if you have questions, if you want to go beyond what I tell you, I really recommend to just Google MatGraph, and you will find talks, slides, even examples of models, implementations, and things like that. So actually, that's something very nice. Today, we are going to just have a look at how it works, to run a few examples. Also, we will show how to use the scotogenic model that we have implemented in MatGraph, so that if you have any model in mind and you want to run collider simulations, you can basically repeat what we do and do it with the same process, with the MatGraph and SATA. And that's basically the idea. Okay, MatGraph, well, I didn't mention this, but maybe some of you already knew. It's a code which is especially designed for collider simulations. So if you have in mind, okay, I have a model and I want to estimate or to calculate what is the cross-section for this process at the LHC, you can do it with MatGraph. Or you want to estimate the number of events and the background for a particular final state in a particular model that you like, you have to do it with MatGraph. Okay? So this is the idea. The code is written in Python. That means that you don't need to compile. Python is interpreted, you don't need to compile. You just have to download the code, you untar the folder, we will do it now. And then you can run already. You don't need to compile anything. You can do it from this website, but there is one thing that you need to know, which is that in order to download the code, you need to register. There is no problem with that, but probably they like to have a record of people who download the code. I mean, you can do it in some minutes, and you download the code, and they never send you a message. They never send you spam, nothing. But they want you to register.
I think this depends on the page, right? Because they have two pages and one they don't require to register.
Official one?
Not that one, the another one. If you Google it, MatGraph.
Okay, maybe they have a different website. the official website is this one, so this is the one I trust. Maybe there is a pirate version of MatGraph. I mean, it's for free.
Seems
you
pretty
know,
official.
It's just, okay, register. You just need to register. Anyway, so as I said, MatGraph basically takes care of collider simulation. And why is this a complicated issue? Okay, there are basically three steps you have to follow every time you want to simulate, to fully simulate a collider process. The first one is the most basic one, which is events at the particle level. For example, you want to calculate the cross-section for TT bar production at the LHC. So this would be partons, so quarks and gluons in the proton to TT bar. That's it, end of the story. Okay? And this is something that you can even do by hand. You can calculate the cross-section, you can get an analytical expression, and then you put the values of the parameters and you get the final result. Sometimes it's really complicated because you have many particles, but in principle this is doable by hand. The next step is the showering and the harmonization. And you know that these tops or whatever particles you have, they decay, they produce shower of particles, or they hadronize if they are hadronic, like quarks or gluons. So this is something that is done in a second step. Once you have this first simulation at the partonic level, then you start making things a little bit dirtier by putting all this hadronic activity and the showering. And this is done by a different piece of matter. The first part is, what you may call mud event, which is just the event simulation. And the second part is done by something called PTS, which is a code that takes care of all this hadronization and showering. And also PTS by itself, also a very complicated thing that includes links to other tools like this one, and this one. In particular, I know this one because there are some people at IFIC involved. This is to simulate taus. Okay, so this is a very important code for people at IFIC. And this is also part of all this second process. But there is a third step. Because, okay, you have already all these jets, these showerings, you have pions, you have everything, all this mess in the final stage. But then the detector is not perfect. So if you want to really simulate an event at the LHC, you also have to simulate the detector. What happens with the detector? And this is the third step. Okay, so you need another code that takes care of what happens in the detector, because they are not always efficient. For some final, for some states, they may have better efficiency than for others, and then all these things may be important if you want to do something realistic. And this is again done by a different code, which is called PGS. And there is an alternative, which is DELSET, which is also very much, I mean, this is used very often in the community. Okay, this may look really complicated because you have to combine many different codes, but the nice thing about MatGraph is that it's already combined. You don't have to do anything. In principle, you have the freedom to download or to compile or to use these three different codes individually. You run the first one, you take the output, you move it to the second one, and so on and so forth. You can do that if you want. But you can also tell MatGraph, please, I want to do a simulation that includes all the steps. And then MatGraph, without you telling anything else, makes this process for you. So it uses the output of this one for this one, and then the output of this one for this one. And you get the final result. Actually, whenever you want to do a simulation with MatGraph, there is a question. To what level you want to reach? And then you have to decide whether you want to stop here, here, or here. Depending on your physical internet, what you want to compute, you may be happy just calculating a simulation at the partonic level. Maybe you are more interested in what happens after hadronization. Then you have to go to the second level, and so on. Okay, this is an option that the user has. But the good thing about MatGraph is that everything is combined. Okay, so this is what I wanted to tell you. And now the next thing would be to simulate this parameter point that we have considered already for the other lectures in MatGraph. Okay, this is what I want to show you. But first, we have to install MatGraph. So let's see how one can do that. Okay, so I assume you have downloaded the code. I did it this morning. So I have this MatGraph file. This file. So you just have to untark the file in the usual way. And then, when you untark it, you get this new folder, mg5, blah, 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 which is full of things. Inside the bin folder, you have the binary file that you can already run. We are going to use this one, mg5amc. Okay, so you didn't need to, we didn't need to compile anything to get the binary file. It's already there, so you can run it. Okay, let me close this because otherwise Dropbox will be sending messages. Okay, so in order to run MatGraph, it's super simple. You just have to do to run this binary file, which is in the bin folder, and then oh, MatGraph is already loaded. We are already in MatGraph. Now, in MatGraph there are many nice things, and one of them is that it is very easily connected it is very user-friendly, I would say. There are many parts of Malgraph which are designed to make them visual. And for this, it uses, for example, Firefox or Google Chrome to display some of the results. But in order to choose which particular browser, you have to select an option. So you have to configure Malgraph. Also, in some parts of the running, it will ask you questions. Like, would you like to modify some of the parameters? Would you like to modify the way the run is going to behave? And in order to reply, you may open a file, change some options, and so on. And again, you have to choose which program do you want to use to open this file. Okay? All these things are defined in a file which is inside this input folder. So let me go inside input, and I have here this ng file configuration. So the first thing that I like to do whenever I start using Malgraph is to configure the program to my taste, if you want. So I just open the file with a text editor, and you see this is a long file, okay, with many different options. But in particular, for example, I like Emacs. So in text editor here, I say text editor, I uncomment, and I say Emacs. Also for the web browser, we can use Firefox, Google Chrome, whatever you like. Let's say, well, by default I think it's Firefox, so I don't need to modify this. Okay? There is something else that is interesting, which is this thing here. As I said, when you run Malgraph, sometimes the code asks you questions, like, okay, so you want to change some parameter, you want to do something. And then you have some time to answer. If you don't answer, it takes some default answer. So the default time is 60 seconds. Since I'm going to be talking while launching these codes, it may happen that I miss the 60 seconds. So let me change it to, I don't know, 300, 5 minutes. So that I have plenty of time to talk. Otherwise, the code will continue, even if I don't want it. And okay, there are other options. You can explore this file. So this is the file where you configure all the options in Malgraph. Okay, I'm happy with it. I close. Okay, the next thing that is important is that I mentioned here that there are some additional codes like PTA or PGS that you can use if you want to do a more advanced simulation. These codes do not come by default with Malgraph. If you want to have them, you have to install them. But this is very easy because you can use a command inside Malgraph to install them and link it properly with the rest of the codes. And this is done with install and then PGS, no, PTR PGS. The only thing is that in order to do that, you need to be online because it will download the code and install it. Okay, I am online, so I can do it. It's downloading the code, this PTR and PGS, these two different pieces, and installing it. The connection here is not very good, but okay. This is, again, optional. If you never, just so that you will never use these additional steps in the simulation, you don't need to install these different codes. You can say, okay, I'm fine with this. I don't need to run harmonization, showering, and detector response. But I think it's a good idea to do these installations as soon as possible, because that way you're sure you will never have problems with compatibility and things like that. Now it's compiling different codes. It's really fast. Thank you. thing. Okay, so now we are ready to use macros for complete collider simulations. As I said, one of the nicest things about MicGraph is that it's really user-friendly. It doesn't look like at this point, I agree with you, but it becomes better, as you will see. And one of the things they have that I really like is that they have a tutorial. So you can run the tutorial, and I really recommend you do it as one of the first steps. And actually, I will do it now. So you just have to type tutorial. Okay, so the tutorial is basically what I said. We are going to run proton-proton to top and to top. So the production of a top and an anti-top at the LHC. Okay, this is the idea. There are some messages that you probably would like to read if you repeat this at home. Basically by telling you that there are some additional commands, like how to get help on a command, blah blah blah. But it's really easy, really easy. Basically every time you want to generate a process, the first thing is to use this command generate. Generate and then proton proton to top anti-top. This is the way you explain to MicGraph that you want to simulate this process. Then you enter. And the next thing is, okay, I want to save my results in some particular folder. So you have to define the folder where you want to save your results. We are going to use the name suggested by MicGraph, my first MG5 run. Okay? But you can use whatever name you want. This is just the name of the folder. Now, the folder is being created, finished, and if you have a look at the folder, the main MicGraph folder, you will see that it was created. Okay, there is this folder that we just created in the tutorial. If I go inside, there are inside many different files, and in particular there is also a folder called cards. This is a very important folder. Okay. In this folder we have many different .dat files. These are the so-called cards. Cards are the names given by the people in MicGraph to the different text files where we input different details about the simulation. For example, there is one card that is called parent card. This is the file where we give the input parameters of our model. If I just open it, you will see, now we are working with the standard model, okay? So you will see the parameters in the standard model. So the masses of the different particles, you have the quarks, the set, the Higgs boson, the tau. Also you have some decay widths, which are set to zero, because they are computed internally, this is not important. Some parameters, like alpha electromagnetic, or E Fermi, things like that. Yukawas, and some other options. Okay, so this is where the parameters of your model are. There is another file called plot card, in case you want to tell MicGraph, once you're done, I also want a plot. Then you have to specify here the details of the plot. Or rank card, actually this is very important, rank card. Let me open it. This is a text file where you specify some details, important details about the rank, about the simulation. For example, here you have the name of the run, okay? Sorry. Here you have the name of the run that you can change. If you want to run for several times in the same model with different parameters, maybe you want to give a specific name to each run. Also, you have the number of events. Okay, all simulations in MicGraph are done by Monte Carlo methods. So you basically use many random numbers which try to emulate what happens at the LHC, the basic random nature of quantum mechanics. And this is done with a given number of events. In this case, typically by default is 10,000. It is very important to select a good number of events. If you select too many, it will take forever to finish. If you take too few, the problem is that the final result will be statistically unreliable. So suppose you are trying to simulate the production of a particle that really has a very low cross-section. So it's very unlikely that you will produce it. And you take a very low number of events. Then the probability that one of these events produces this particle is really low. So the calculation of the cross-section will be unreliable. And all the processes, all the results that you get with this process will be kind of unreliable. In that case, you should better have a larger number of events. Otherwise, what you get is not enough. Okay? One way to see it is that if you repeat the same simulation twice and you get very different results, you didn't choose a correct number of events. You should get similar results if you repeat the simulation. If not, you are doing something wrong. Okay? Also, you can choose the type of beam. Well, 1-1 is proton to proton, which is the IHC. But you can also run proton on antiproton, or you can run photon on proton, photon on electron. Okay? So you can change the type of collider. In this course, we will only consider the LHC, okay? So it will be always proton on proton. And finally, you can also change here the energy of each beam. And you know that the LHC has been upgrading and then increasing the energy, center of mass energy. This is done with these two different numbers. So this is the energy of the first beam, and this is the energy of the second beam, in G. Okay? Also, you can polarize the beams, you can change the PDFs, you can do many different things, okay? And this is done in this file. Okay, and you have other files where you can change, for example, the properties of the detector trigger or the way the harmonization is done in Pipia. I mean, there are many, many different details, and you really need to be an expert to understand everything that you can play with in Minecraft. Okay, so let's continue with the tutorial. So we just created this folder where we are going to simulate proton-proton to top anti-top. And this is done with this command launch. Launch. And then the name of the folder. Okay? And as I told you, now questions. The first question is, okay, you want to simulate proton-proton to top anti-top, but at what level? Do you want to run the partonic level simulation? You want to do harmonization and showering? Or you want to do everything up to the detector response? If you wanted to do something really, really realistic, you would say, okay, I want to do even detector response. But this takes time, and for this course, we will consider only the first level. In that case, you just say you type 1 and enter. If you wanted to do detector response, you would type 3. Because this is, you would type 2. Because this is detector simulation with PES. If you just wanted the showering and the harmonization, you would type 1. Sorry, actually I have to type 0. Okay? This is the lowest level. There is no difference at all, eh? It just takes more time to finish. Next, question is, do you want to edit any card? For example, do you want to edit parameter card, rank card, whatever? In this case, I would say no, but if you wanted to change, for example, the mass of the top port, you would have a chance to do it. Or if you wanted to use more events, basically you could do this. If you don't want anything, you say either 0 or enter. And then the simulation starts. Now we are using random events, and the computer is calculated. Simultaneously, Minecraft opens for you Firefox, a browser, where the information about what is happening is updated every, I don't know, 10 seconds or something like that. So now it's compiling the directory. But there are no results yet. So this is live. You can see what the code is doing live. Results in the standard model for proton-proton to top antitops. Also, here you get additional thing. Ah, this, I don't know why, there is a bug, I think. Sometimes you need to close for this to continue. Don't ask me why. This I don't know why, but it happened to me sometimes, not always. I will open again the Firefox later, don't worry. Actually, I can open it now, if you want. The Firefox is saved in this index. Where is this index? Firefox. Okay, here it is. So let's wait until this is finished. Okay, it's finished already. Okay, once it's finished, you can already check what is the calculated cross-section and many different things. So let's go, for example, to process information. Okay? In process information, you have the different Feynman diagrams that Minecraft just computed to calculate this cross-section. and they are divided in different categories. The first category, which is this line here, it's, as you can see, based on quark. You will see later what that means. And the second is gluon. You can open the Feynman diagram with this link, and you see the Feynman diagram of this category. So this is quark, mediated by gluon, goes to top and the top. Okay? This is the Feynman diagram of this category. If you select the other, again, you can go here, and you have the diagrams of this category. In this case, you don't pick up the quark content of the proton, but the gluon content. So gluon, and top anti-top in the final state in all cases. You can also open the diagrams in PostScript, actually. And this is very nice because you can import this PostScript in your paper if you want. This is a PS file that you can use. You can even modify if you have some skills with the PostScript and add some labels or whatever you want. So this is nice. You can also see that each diagram is labeled with two numbers, QCD and TBD. QED is the number of electromagnetic vertices that appear in the diagram, and QCD, strong vertices. Typically, unless you specify something different, if there are too many diagrams and some of them have QCD different from zero and QED equals zero, these are neglected. Because Markgraf knows that QCD is way more important than QED in a hadronic collider. So typically, when you have too many diagrams, these are neglected. Those with QED different from zero or QCD equal to zero. This is not the case, but it may happen. Okay, so this is regarding the different diagrams. Also, you can go to the results and event database link. And in this case, you get the final result of the simulation. In this case, the final result is the cross-section. So we have computed that the cross-section for this process is 500 picograms. Of course, if you repeat the simulation, you don't get exactly the same number because this is a random simulation. You will get something similar, not exactly the same. And in principle, Markgraf has taken care of that by using this error. It assigns a statistical error to the simulation. That's it. That's basically the idea of using Markgraf. Now, of course, you can do many more things. If you go to this event folder, rank one, this is what we just did, you have these different files. These files are in very specific formats, and they collect a lot of information about the simulation. As I told you, you can read already from this number the cross-section. But you may be interested, for example, in what are the typical directions of this top and the top. Or what is the angular distribution of the top decays if I let it decay. Or, you know, there are many, many different important details about the simulation which are not displayed on the browser, but you can read in these files. And we will do that tomorrow. Right? Tomorrow we will do something a bit more complicated with Markgraf. And we will see how to plot, for example, the number of events as a function of the invariant mass of some particles. Okay? This simulation is too trivial, but tomorrow we'll do something a bit more complicated, and you will see how to take advantage of this one. Okay, so we can close this, and the basic tutorial is done. You can continue on doing more complicated stuff, but instead of doing that with the tutorial, we will use the Scott-Jenkins curve. Okay? Question so far?
Yeah. Can you do loops with this? Or?
This is Markgraf at the next two leading order. Okay, so in principle, you can do loops, but in order to do that, you have to configure something. I don't know exactly where, but you have to specify that you want to include higher order corrections.
So for instance, the Higgs, you can do it here.
Ah, okay, you mean...
Higgs to do photon, for
okay,
instance.
Okay, no, that's a bit more complicated. This you cannot do, but you can fake it.
Okay.
There is a model, okay, let me show you. There is... okay, this is the main Markgraf folder, okay? There are several subfolders, and one of them is these models, okay? There are already several models implemented in Markgraf that you can use already out of the box. You don't need to do anything else. IFIC UVEG-CSIC is of course the standard model, but there are other models. The next thing we are going to do is to put here this photogenic model, okay? But the question you're asking is this HEFT. This is Higgs effective theory, okay? And the idea is that in this model you have the standard model plus Higgs gluon-gluon and Higgs photon-photon couplings, okay, which are three parameters. So you have to fake it like this. You have to simulate the coupling by putting it by hand. Otherwise, you cannot do it. But of course, if you want to calculate Higgs production in my graph,
yeah,
you need that coupling,
yeah,
for gluon fusion.
Yeah.
Okay. What do you mean that those are three parameters? Those are not three parameters in the standard model for sure. So you have to give the...
Yeah, in the standard model, by free, I mean independent, that you can change the value you want. But by default, it takes the standard model analytical. I can show you.
I don't want to go into those many details. It's in couplings, I think. Couplings. Not here.
Ah, no, vertices maybe.
Vertices?
Yes. Okay. So this is the list of vertices in this model, which is, as I said, the standard model with these additional couplings. So there should be something like PH, PH, no, sorry, PH, PG, PG, for example. This one. This is the gluon-gluon Higgs coupling. Okay? And you have to go to this coupling, which is in the other file. So this is G313. But it should be here. Ah, it's here. Okay.
It's fine, I believe you.
Okay, you have to look for the definition of this GH, which is somewhere. So it's a bit more complicated. GH should be probably in parameters. Yes, okay. So this is the analytical expression for that coupling, which is the standard model calculation of the gluon-gluon Higgs coupling. But if you want, you can remove this and change it and put the value you want. So you can fake a different model by putting here an effective coupling of your preference. This is what I wanted to say. And you have the same with the photon somewhere else. Okay. Okay. So now we are going to implement the scotogenic in this in my graph. And again, in order to do that, we will take advantage of sun. Okay, so this is the file we are using all the time in this course. So, as usual, the first thing you have to do, you load SARA and you load the scotogenic model. Okay, finished. And then, in order to create these MatGraph files, you need to use this command, make UFO. UFO comes from Universal Feynman rules something. I think it's format. I'm not sure. It's a format for this type of codes. Okay. Every time you do this, you have to compute all the vertices. Okay. There are some warnings which are not relevant because they have to do with the fine art number of these particles. This is not relevant. And it's that. Okay.
So okay. These fake one-loop vertices, can you make them with SARA, for instance, or
no?
Okay.
I mean, with SARA you can get the analytical expressions, but then you will have to
copy and paste
and do something more traditional.
Okay. So so I finish with this file, and inside the usual SARA output folder. Now we have a new subfolder called UFO, where these files can be found. Okay, so these are the files for this particular model, for the cosmogenic model. So we just have to go to my graph, and in this folder where all the models can be found, we create a new folder called cosmogenic, for example, and then we copy all of them to that folder. Models, so they should be here already. Here they are. Okay. So now we can already use the cosmogenic model in macro. And so the first thing you have to do every time you load a model is to say the model you want. So we are going to say import. Okay, this is the command. Import and then the name of the model. Okay. Important. So now we are going to use with a model. Now, important detail, when you use a model that you have implemented by yourself, you have to tell MatGraph to use the names of the particles that you have defined. And this is done with a very specific command that most people don't know. Actually, I was wrong. Actually, the way you import the model is import cosmogenic and then this command that I forgot, of this specification. Model name, okay? Import models cosmogenic model name. This model name is what I wanted to tell you now. You have to say, please use the names used in my implementation. Because otherwise, it tries to find an electron and it doesn't know what an electron is. It tries to find a gluon, it doesn't know what a gluon is. So this is the way to tell MatGraph, use the names that I used in my implementation. Okay. Now, in that part there is something very nice. You can define something called multiparticle. Multiparticle is nothing but a set of particles that have the same properties. For example, jet. So you could say a jet is everything that is coming from a gluon and a quark. So this is what multiparticles are. So you can say display multiparticles, and then you have a list of all the multiparticles that have been defined. Okay, or includes everything. L is E1 and E2, so electrons and muons. You can also define anti-L, which would be positrons and anti-muons. Jet would be gluons and first and second generation quarks. Neutrinos, neutrinos. L plus is, as I said, the conjugate of L minus. And then you also define proton as anything that belongs to this category. So basically, proton and jet are the same. So gluons and quarks are the first generation. Okay, this neglects the contribution to the proton coming from the third generation. That is non-zero, but it's smaller than the first and second. So you see, you have the gluon and the different quarks in the first two generations. Okay, so now we are going to run a process in the cosmogenic model. What process? Okay, the process you have in mind would be okay, but I already selected one, which is for this particular benchmark point, this process. Okay, this is proton-proton that goes into a eta real, eta plus. Okay, these are the scalars that we have in this model that we don't have in the standard model. So let's do something that is specific to this model. Okay, how do we do this? So again, generate. This is the way you specify the process. Proton-proton to eta r, eta plus. Okay, these are the names of the particles that we have here. Okay, generator. Next thing, as we did in the tutorial, we have to create the folder where all the information will be saved. So output, and then, for example, simulation in the cosmogenic. This is the name of the folder. Create. Next thing, we want to run, so just launch. Okay, this is the command to launch. And then questions.
again, do you want to run a complete simulation or just want to stay at the first level or the second level? Or we will say just normal simulation, because otherwise it takes very long. Now, do you want to edit a card? Okay, now we have to say something. Why? Because if you have a look at the parameters card that we have in this model, so let me show you. We have here this sims cotogenic that we just created. And inside we have these cards. Okay? Then we have this param card, which is the text file with the values of the parameters. You see that everything is initialized to zero. So if you run in this parameter point, you get 1,000 errors and it doesn't work, because all the parameters are zero. So we have to change the values of the parameters, and for that we are going to use this benchmark point. So we are going to use the same parameters that we used for the previous calculation with the other programs. How to do that? It may seem that you have to change every parameter by hand, but for that, again, we will take advantage of the fact that this input file is again a Lesueux input file. So you can easily see that the information is divided in blocks with some numbers, so it's exactly the same format that we are using in Sphino. So we can again copy the output of Sphino and use it as input for Macro. We are going to do exactly the same we did with Macromeras. So you see, when these people met to agree on a common format, it was really useful for the most part. Otherwise, you have to rewrite all the parameters all the time. So let me go to Sphino. Okay. So let me make sure that I have the Lesueux point that I wanted. Yes. So we run Sphino just to make sure that this is the correct output. Okay. And now this output file is going to be the parameters file for Matter. Okay. So we just copy this Sphino SPC file to Matter. Matgraph, then sims cotogenic, so our folder, the folder we are using to run, then cards, and then we are going to replace the file that we had there by this one. So we are going to rename this file. Okay, we copy it. Okay, now we are done. So if we just open the file again, we will see that this is the file we created with Sphino. It's not the file with everything set to zero as it was before. So we are done, so we can say enter, because we don't want to modify any other option. Okay? Then we get some warnings. These are okay. This has to do with some formats and conventions. And then the simulation has started. This is going to be a bit longer than the previous one, I think, but not much. Finished. Now we can open the browser again to see the result of the simulation. We can do that as before, or we can use also inside Markdown, there is this open command that you can use directly. Open index, and then you get the result of the simulation. Okay, the first thing you may be interested in is the result for the cross-section. You can see that the result is now tiny number. This is at the level of 0.7 femtobarns, which is a very small cross section. Well, not very small, but small cross section. And you may wonder why we got 500 before and now we get 0.0007. And this is because before, when we calculated top anti-top, this is a process that takes place with strong interactions. So this is mediated by gluons, quarks, and everything. Whereas this one, if we go to the Feynman diagrams, we see, for example, here in the first category, let me open the other one, which looks nicer. You see in the first category that this is mediated by a W. So this is an electroweak interaction process. Okay? That's why the cross section is much smaller. But that's it. I mean, this is okay. This is what one should expect. and the cross section should be much lower. Now, if you want to get the number of events, you could continue and doing more complicated simulation, and you can also estimate. Basically, the number of events is basically cross section times luminosity. So, for example, if you have a luminosity of about 300 inverse femtobar, which is the final luminosity one could expect that they see, and you multiply by 0.7 femtobar, you would get basically 200 and something events. So the number of events you would expect that they see, you can estimate by doing these numbers. Of course, this doesn't tell you that you will have 250 beautiful events at the LHC, because you also have to simulate the background. Okay? There may be other processes that after these guys decay, the eta real and the eta plus decay, lead to the same final result. So you will have to simulate the background, compare the number of events in the background with the number of events that you have in your process, and then compare to see what would be the excess of the process in your model with respect to the background. Okay, this would be the idea of a simulation of the LHC.
Can you do chain processing? Like in the same, now the eta decay into something?
Yes, this is what we are going to do now.
Okay, sorry.
Well, actually we are going to do something a bit more complicated. So let me close this and this. Okay. So the next thing I wanted to do is to consider the following. So these two guys decay. So these are not stable. These decay. And for example, they could decay like this. So they could decay the first one to singlet and neutrino, and the second one to singlet and a plus, for example. Why not? And then the total process, since this singlet is stable, because there is a set to symmetry, and this is the dark matter of the universe, the final state would be singlet, singlet, mu plus neutrino. Okay? So you may think, okay, I want to study the production of these four guys in the final state, but going through these intermediate states. Okay? I want to produce them on shell, and then they decay. This is done with, if you remember the syntax, is PP goes to eta R eta P, and then comma eta R goes to whatever and eta P goes to whatever. Okay, this is the way you concatenate additional processes. But if you do that, you will only consider all the intermediate states that go through those two particles. But there may be other mechanisms to produce those four final particles. Okay? So imagine you are in your office and you are discussing with someone, okay, I want to study final states with N1, N1, mu plus, mu trio. What are the diagrams that contribute to this process? Okay, you already have in mind this eta R, eta plus production, and then these guys decay, no? This would be the diagram you have in mind. So you have proton, proton, then through a W, this goes to eta plus, eta R, okay? And now this goes to N1, mu plus, and this goes to N1 and mu trio. Okay? So you already have a diagram to produce those guys. But I'm completely sure that in a model like this, there will be other diagrams that will go finally to the same final states. So how can you make sure that you have the complete list of diagrams that go to that final state? Okay, so the last part of the session will be to show you, and this is very simple, you will see in a moment, how to get all the diagrams that go to that final process, to that final state, sorry. And this is done basically by simulating the whole thing. So PP, 2, and then N1, N1. Let me remember the names of these particles. E2 bar. And then VL. Okay, so N1, N1, it's obvious. E2 bar is the mu plus. Okay? And VL is the multiparticle name that we use for any neutrino. So VL is any neutrino, because we cannot distinguish in a collider between 1, 2, and 3. Okay, we generate. And now, only by doing this, now you have to use this output, and then you have to define a folder where you want to save all the information. let's say now seems cotogenic 2, okay, because this is in the second simulation in the cotogenic model. Okay, and automatically, once you do this, you can already see in this browser, this information, you can see already the different diagrams, because these are already generated. So let me show you the diagrams. So if you go here, for example, you will see no encontrado, because there are no results. We didn't do any simulation. We are about to do the simulation. We are about to start. We didn't do any simulation, but we already have all the different diagrams. So you can start looking at the diagram, for example, like this. And you see all the different diagrams that go to the final state that we have considered. So this one is here. So the one we have on the blackboard or whiteboard is this diagram here. But you see that, for example, we can have so proton-proton goes to W plus, and then W plus goes to E plus neutrino, and then E plus goes to eta plus. You see all the different processes that in the end go to the same final state. So this is a trick that I like, because this way, if you want to discuss a process on the blackboard, you don't need to think, am I missing any diagram? You do this and you get all of them. And then maybe some of them are irrelevant, but you get the whole list. Okay? So this is a nice practical thing. Okay, so this is what I wanted to tell you about the math graph. Tomorrow, the plan for tomorrow is to repeat what we did in lectures 1, 2, and 3 with a different model. So we will take a little bit more complicated model. The scotogenic is super simple. So we will take a bit more complicated model. We will implement it in SARA. We will run some parameter points in Sphino. We will see the masses, the decay weights, everything. Then we will calculate the, because in that model there will be dark matter, we will calculate the Rayleigh density, and we will do a collider simulation with that model. So I guess you will have probably some doubts, some questions about what we did in the lectures 1, 2, and 3. But I hope tomorrow, by repeating this with a different model, everything gets crystal clear. Okay? Also, there is something that I need to tell you. Tomorrow, we will run a simulation like today, but a bit more complicated simulation, in which not only we want to see the cross-section, but we would like to see some kinematical distribution, something like that. Okay? As I said, this information is in the in these event files, which are saved in the folders in MATLAB. You can open these files and write a code to read these files and make a plot, something like that. But there is already a very, very, very nice code called MAD analysis, which is written by some people in the MAD team, that already does this for you. So you just say, I want to plot this. It goes to these files and plots this nicely for you. So I recommend you install MAD analysis, because that way tomorrow you can reproduce the plots. But in order to use MAD analysis, there is a prerequisite, which is root. Maybe some of you know about root. Root is a framework for plotting, for data analysis, that was developed by people at CERN. It's a very complicated framework, so if you really know how to use it, you are a super master. But it's wonderful if you just want to extract this information from this event file and get a plot. So my recommendation, if you want to plot tomorrow the results of the simulations, if you don't want to plot, that's okay. But if you want to plot, I recommend to install root and then MAD analysis, because these two things are very useful when you want to plot the results of the simulation. If not, I mean, I will do it for you, and I will have it, so you just look at the screen and that's it. But it's nice, and we will discover a particle tomorrow. Right? So, tomorrow we will discover a particle, so that's it. Questions? Comments?
Okay, I have a final question. Now you have all the diagrams that contribute to this final process, final decay.
Yes.
Can you select the different diagrams to see which one is dominant?
Ah, very good question. Actually, I forgot to mention this. Yes, this is a good question. Actually, this information is actually saved. So let me... yes. So this is the folder for the first simulation we did in the scotogenic model, where we calculated a cross-section. So let me open this index file. Okay, this is the first simulation we did, where we calculated the cross-section. Remember? Mm-hmm. Now, if you click here, you get that information. You get the different weight for each diagram. So the total cross section is here, and you have the different, well, this is basically the same, but you have, well, for each diagram, what is the different relative contribution. Or if you do this, maybe this is more illustrative if I do it for the tutorial. So in the tutorial, we did basically the same thing. So this was top and the top production, okay? And there were several diagrams, and if you do that, you get, again, basically the same. So the total cross-section is about 500 picobarns, and the contribution from gluon-gluon is 440, and the contribution from quark-quark is 60. So you conclude that gluon-gluon is more important. Okay? This is a good question, yes. You can actually access more information. You can access more information if you click. I mean, you can get more detailed information about the simulation, the technical details of the different diagrams, and so on and so forth. So, I mean, you can really spend the whole day by looking at these results, and there is probably a lot of information you will never understand, because this is really a very, very complicated program with many details. But, okay, if you just want to calculate a cross-section, which is very simple.
Okay, and once you know that, can you tell the program to only compute one of the contributions? For instance, you might want to make it faster and the others,
yes, no? You can do that. You can do that. I don't remember how to do it, but you can do that. Before you say launch, so you have generated all the diagrams.
Yeah.
There is a command to say select only these diagrams. You can do that. Yes. I don't remember the command, but
yeah.
You can do that.
I have one more command. So for this final state, I mean, I see that only the muon is the observable thing. So it should not be this muon plus three neutrinos should be also considered as a background, like instead of muon, because you are never going to observe n1, n1 or neutrinos.
Yeah, I agree with you, yes. So yes. I mean, with this way you get the cross-section for this final state. But what you are saying is correct. These other final states would be background.
Yeah.
So you would have to compute that independently, and they put everything together. Okay. So you have to simulate the background and the signal independently.
Yeah, I mean, actually the signal is basically muon plus missing energy.
Yes.
Not muon.
Yes.
N1.
Yes.
And another thing is that this program actually gives you the final state energy integrated. I mean, it's not at, say, eta plus eta resonance. So, I mean, if I so fix the energy of the final state, like the invariant mass of the final state, then
yes,
that can give me a better significance for this process.
Sure, sure.
Is that
I mean, this number is the integrated number, of
yes,
course.
But can I?
Yes, yes. I mean, as I said, in these files, let me close this. In these files here, in these events, these files. These files contain this LHE and LHE here as well. These files contain information about each event in your simulation. So we ran 10,000 events. Each event contains top and anti-top in this case, or whatever, with a particular energy and a particular momentum in some direction, some rapidity, whatever variables you are interested in. So all this information is saved. Now you can plot that information and say, okay, select only, or extract that information, select only events in which the invariant mass of these two guys are within these two different values.
Yeah.
And then, yes, I mean, you can play with that as much as you want. But you have to do it like after the simulation. So you simulate everything, and then you extract the result of the simulation, and you start playing with that. So tomorrow we will plot the number of events as a function of an invariant mass. And that way you will see that, of course, if you select an invariant mass, which is an interesting region, you get a signal. If not, you get a signal. So it's important to concentrate on a particular region. Yes, but that's where the physics comes in, no? I mean, so far it's just technology. I mean, to know what to do is a different story. Other questions? Okay. Well, if not, tomorrow, as I said, we will basically repeat the steps with a different model. We will see, well, it's not so complicated. It's actually a very simple model. But the nice thing is that it has a few more elements. So you will see a few more details. And in any case, if we will repeat everything, if there is some doubt, some question about, you can of course ask me. But also you can wait until tomorrow and maybe you see it again and then it becomes completely clear. Okay? That's it. See you tomorrow.